Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 8, and I'm reading the whole psalm. Please listen to these words as we proclaim that our God is the God of gods. Verse 1. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? You have made them a little lower than the angels, and crowned them with glory and honor. You have made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds, and the animals of the wild, the birds of the sky, and the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We heard Jesus say in Matthew that all authority has been given to him in heaven and on earth. And because we are in Jesus Christ, we have the victory. So let us praise the Lord in song, in singing that wonderful hymn, Mine Eyes Have Seen the Coming of the Glory of the Lord, or simply known as the Victory Song.
Oh,
Good morning. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I wish to welcome you to our service today, where we've gathered to praise, to worship, and just become silent at the foot of the cross. It is a great honor and a privilege for me to yet again come to you over the airwaves and just to share the Word of God with you. But before we get started, or before I do any intimations, may I inquire how you are doing? Are you still coping? Are you still there? I want to encourage you today and say to you, you must never give up. God is always there and God has got you. Just reach out to Him, take His hand, and walk with Him. I have one or two intimations for you today. Please take note that on the 25th of June, Julius Magan, the evangelist singer, will be here with us at Church on Tin Road. Please come and join us. Bring your family, bring your friends. Let's have a wonderful day of worship with Julius. Then, on the 23rd of July, we have a Poikikos Day. Everybody is welcome. Again, family, friends, come and join us. The tickets are 50 Rand, which entitles you to a proper lunch. And when I'm saying a lunch, I'm not saying a plate of food, because sometimes people go back for seconds or even thirds, and it is so nice. So come and join us. What value for money? 50 Rand for a lunch on the 23rd of July here at Church on Tin. And then on the 30th of July, we have our annual general meeting, which will be part of the service that day. Please, that is the time you come and you say your say. This is where you come, and if you've got ideas or you just want to hear what's happening in the church, that is the time to come. So please make a note of that date, 30th of July, as part of the service, we will have our AGM. But let us do what we came to do, to praise, to worship, to hear the Word of God. Our first lesson today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, and I'm reading from verses 16 to 20. It's a passage that is very well known to us all, but hear the Word of God. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
the time to give your heart. Oh, come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come.
One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure.
Join me as we come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Dear Lord God and Heavenly Father, dear Lord Jesus and Holy Spirit, we greet you today, Lord, as we come into your presence with singing and praising you and worshiping you and proclaiming that you are our God. Oh yes, Lord, you are our Lord because you are the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. And you are the one that sent your Son to die on the cross for us. And yes, Lord Jesus, you took all that punishment, all that humiliation, so that we could be set free. Oh Lord, we stand in awe of you. And to make it even better, Lord Jesus, when you ascended into heaven, you sent us your Holy Spirit to come and dwell within us, because your Holy Spirit is our counselor and our advocate. We praise you and we worship you. O Lord, as we come into your presence this morning, Lord, we can only stand and say thank you, thank you, thank you. And today as we celebrate this Trinity Sunday, proclaiming that you are the Triune God, the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. O Lord, we can only stand and wonder what it is that makes you love us. We know that we are not worthy, but Lord, we bless you for everything you do for us. But we also know you created us, each and every one of us. And Lord, you say in your scriptures, you loved us first. And this morning we respond in loving you back. Oh Lord, thank you for this opportunity that we can come and learn, come and hear your word, and just be still before you. So, Lord, we pray today as we come that you will speak to us, that you will show us our purpose in life, that you will show us what it is that you expect from us, that you'll open our minds and our hearts so that truly we may hear you. So, Lord, we pray take away any stubbornness or resistance so that we can hear you. And Lord, as I bring your message to these your people, Holy Spirit, I pray that you will take control of me and that everything I say will be your words, Lord, and that those words will bring you honor and glory at all times. So, Lord, we pray, be with us now. Hold us, bless us, and teach us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our second lesson today comes from Paul's letter to the church in Corinth. So it's 2 Corinthians chapter 13, and I'm reading just from verses 11 to 14. And this is the epilogue of Paul to the Corinthians in his second letter. And he writes, "Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All God's people here send their greetings. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." I only read thus far. May the Lord bless his holy word to us today. Very often when we come to a service, we come with preconceived ideas. And we come with hearts that have become like stone. Let us worship the Lord in song. As we sing that song, "Change My Heart, O God." And as we sing that, let us give our lives to the Lord and let us say to him that he is the potter and we are the clay and he can mold us and do with us what he wants to. At the end of the day, God is the one that created us. So let us have a change of heart and let us with sincerity worship him and praise him. Come, let us sing.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. Change my heart, O God. Ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you.
You are the potter.
Folks, today indeed is yet another very, very special Sunday. The reason being, I wonder how many of you know what Sunday it is today. Yes, today is the Sunday in which we celebrate, again take note, we celebrate the triune God, or as a lot of people refer to it, as the Trinity. Now, today in our exercise, I want us just to have a look. Why is it necessary for us to celebrate the Trinity? And I want you to understand that in God creating us, in God saving us, He uses the Trinity. I mean, we have to look. The other day we spoke on the Holy Spirit, and we need to understand that when everything was created, the Holy Spirit was present. When God created Adam, what happened? He formed his body out of the ground, and then his Holy Spirit. So God the Father creates through Jesus, and then the Holy Spirit brings life to Adam. So you see, God uses the Trinity to create. It's not just God, or it's not just Jesus, or it's not just the Holy Spirit. It's all three. Yes, true. Throughout the Old Testament, he uses mostly God himself and the Holy Spirit. Classic example of that is where Ezekiel is taken to the Valley of Dry Bones by the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that gives vision. When Moses in Numbers 11, when Israel is complaining like crazy about food, Moses goes to God and he says to God, God, I can't handle these people of yours anymore. What must I do? And God says, pick 70 elders. And when Moses gets the 70 elders, it is the Holy Spirit that comes down on them and fills them to do God's work. And Jesus? Well, it is Jesus who comes down, light of the world, you step down into darkness. He comes to this earth through God's master plan in reconciling us to God once again. You hear what I'm saying? Yeah, he uses his son, Jesus, to come to earth, to take the form of a human being, so that he could save us. It is Jesus who gets humiliated. It is Jesus who gets flogged. It is Jesus who goes to the cross. It is Jesus that is nailed to that cross. And it is Jesus who dies on the cross. But it is also Jesus who conquers death and is resurrected. And through his resurrection, he takes authority over bad and good. And he says, if we acknowledge him as Lord and Savior, we are recreated a new creation in him. In other words, in Jesus. And when Jesus, as we celebrated that the other day, when he ascends into heaven, what does he say before he goes up? In my place, I will send you the advocate. And that is what he does. And that advocate is the Holy Spirit. And we celebrated that last Sunday. Remember the reading of the tongues of fire that came down and descended upon the people? So you see, throughout the scriptures, God uses all of himself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. to save us, to save his creation, and to further his kingdom. Now, when we talk of the Trinity, because we as human beings do not have indefinite minds, our minds are not limited. We are limited. And I'm not going to use examples to explain that to you, but there are still so many things that we as human beings cannot explain. Although you do get a lot of human beings that believe they are divine and they can do anything, and then they only come to a rude awakening. But because we are limited in our way of thinking, we cannot in a definite way describe the Trinity. Because a lot of people don't understand this three in one. But we can do illustrations, but I must tell you that no matter what illustration we as human beings bring, our illustrations are going to be flawed. They are going to be limited, but we can only do what we can do. And the illustration I like using when we refer to the Trinity is I like using the example of water. You may say, John, water, what a silly illustration. But just listen to my way of thinking. Remember, God, although he's three in one, he is one being. He is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. So he all three is God. So God here is your common denominator. So God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is one substance. God. Now when you look at water, you have ice, which is frozen water. You have steam, which is water that has been heated and it evaporates into becoming a gas. But all three, the common denominator is water. You've got water, the liquid, water, the solid, which is ice, and you have water, steam, which is a gas. So, whenever you think of God, use that as a type of illustration. I must say to you that it is flawed because water is limited. God is unlimited, and he can never be limited. And we need to understand that God can never be limited. But now, when God uses the Trinity to save us, he then uses the Trinity so that the Trinity may use us who have already been saved to go out and save others. Remember, God wants everyone to come back to him. He wants every human being, his entire creation, to come back and be reconciled to him. And that is why it is so important that we take cognizance of the two passages we read today. Now, if we go to the Matthew text in 28, also known as the Great Commission, in verse 19, Jesus says to his disciples, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations." Now, remember what I've said, and I've said this repeatedly, that we, being Christians, being followers of Jesus, we are both disciples and apostles. Disciples, remember the Greek, you're still going to hear this a lot, the Greek word is mathetes. Mathetes means scholar. In other words, for our entire life, we have to be a scholar of Jesus Christ. We have to learn everything about Jesus Christ. Why? Because we have to strive to be like Jesus. Although we can never be Jesus, we need to strive to be that. But then also, as disciples, we need to be apostles. Because we are being taught everything about Jesus, although we will never know everything, but because we are being taught about Jesus, we must go out and we must teach others. We must become apostles. Aposteleo is the Greek. What does that mean? It means we become messengers. Messengers of what? Messengers of the good news. Now, let's get back to that verse 19. Go and make disciples. In other words, we must go out there, we must get people, and we need to bring them in so that they can become scholars, so that they can learn about Jesus, so that they too can be firstly in the kingdom of God, and secondly, that they can become apostles, that they can go and become messengers of the good news. You understand what I'm saying to you? But now, how do we make people disciples? And there's one, we can come with very, very many different answers. But Paul gives us a clue in his second letter to the church in Corinth. Now, that letter, he gives instructions. He says, strive for full restoration. In other words, we have to strive that everybody is restored to seek Jesus so that we can be like Jesus. Remember what I said, we can never be like Jesus, but we've got to strive. It's got to be our goal to be there. And as it becomes our goal, so we must make it other people's goal to do that. He says we need to encourage one another. In other words, in these times, just ask around. Everybody is depressed. Everybody's spirit is down in tatters because of our current living circumstances. But you know what? When we have Jesus, we don't need to worry about our circumstances because Jesus will take care of us. He is our provider. Remember all those words that you have in describing Jesus? Especially the one, Jehovah Jireh, my provider. There's a song about that, Jehovah Jireh, my provider. So we can be provided for by Jesus. But people out there don't know that. So they need to be encouraged and shown and taught about Jesus so that they can be encouraged. And he says, as his church. Now, why do I use the term church? Because we, as Christians, we are a community of believers, aren't we? And therefore, we are the church. Paul says, be of one mind. He doesn't say we must be the same. No. He doesn't say, I must like what you like, and I must drive what you drive, and I must sing what you sing. No, he's not saying that. He says we must be of one mind. And that mind is our mind should be focused and set on Jesus Christ. And we must live in peace. Now remember what I said to you. Peace, in worldly terms, is the absence of hostility. But as a Christian, peace is the presence of Jesus Christ. Now, if Jesus Christ is present in your life, then surely We will strive to be like Jesus and do what Jesus did. And that is, firstly, to love one another, to accept one another as we may have differences. Remember, nobody is alike. We are all unique in our own special way. And when we can accept one another and love one another unconditionally with our mistakes, that is when Jesus rises up out of us and he becomes the common denominator in our lives. But now, there's something else I just want to point to quickly in this passage of Paul's letter to the church in Corinth. He says, if you live in peace, in other words, your focus is on Jesus and everything you do and strive is for Jesus. He says, and the God of love and the God of peace will be with you. In other words, God's love will be in you and Jesus will be in you. And then he says one thing. He says we must love one another and we must greet one another with a holy kiss. Did you hear that? You need to greet one another with a holy kiss. You may say to me, John, now what the heck is a holy kiss? And what Jesus is referring to here is that a holy kiss is, have you seen when the Europeans, they like doing it, the French and the Itais, they like doing this, is when they get to another one another, they kiss each other on the cheek. Okay? You get some people kiss on the right cheek and then the left cheek, or the left cheek and the right cheek. But they do that because a holy kiss is a way for a Christian to show brotherly or sisterly love and affection, as well as unity and fellowship for a fellow believer in Christ. Did you know that? That is what Paul refers to when he says you must greet each other with a holy kiss. But just stop and think quickly. If you give somebody a holy kiss, you go and you kiss the person on the cheek, or you give that person a hug, what are you doing? Yes, you are showing brotherly love or sisterly love. You're showing affection. You're showing unity and fellowship, but you are also acknowledging that person. In other words, you are saying, hey, you, I acknowledge you and I love you and you are part of me. You are part of my family as a Christian family. You know what that does to that person? That person then feels that he belongs somewhere. He belongs to the family of Jesus Christ. It also implies that with this holy kiss and because you love, that we are all equal. Nobody's better than nobody, because we know in a secular environment we say familiarity breeds contempt. But in Christianity, there is no one better than the other. Remember the words I taught you, primus inter pares, first amongst equals? Remember that? Now with a kiss, you're showing just that. I am not better than you because I am your brother or I'm your sister and I love you with the love of God. And you acknowledge in front of other people that he is a fellow believer in Jesus Christ. Wow! And you know what happens when somebody belongs? They feel loved. They have reason to live. They have reason to follow Jesus Christ. And they do not feel inferior. Do you know how many people fall into depression because of inferiority? And why do people feel inferior? It's because we do not care for one another. A lot of people think they're better than others, and that is why inferior is created and generated. It's then that people feel that they do not belong anywhere. Jesus says, strive for full restoration. That is what Paul says. Paul says, strive for full restoration. Folks, if we can live in unity, and if we can express our love and make people feel wanted and make people feel that they belong, you know what that will lead to? It will lead to the end of depression. It will lead to the end of inferiority. And we can stand as one for Jesus Christ. Is that not what you are longing for today? Is that not what your brother or sister, your wife, anybody around you, is that not what everybody is longing for? Greet one another with a holy kiss. Go out and make disciples of all nations. And you know, there's a part that we always forget to mention. It's verse 20. And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Folks, we are all brothers and sisters in Christ. We have been called to go out to love and to teach. Is that what you are doing? And don't forget the holy kiss. Amen. Come, let us pray. Oh, dear Lord God, we have heard your word to us today, Lord. And yes, Lord, we need to drop our heads in embarrassment and being ashamed of how we treat one another, Lord. Lord, it's not what you've intended. Oh, Lord, we've allowed the secular world to penetrate us, and we've allowed, Lord, for us to copy them, and we judge so easily, and we don't like this person, and we don't like that person. And yes, Lord, you've called us to love one another and to greet each other with a holy kiss. Oh, Lord, help us to realize this. Help us to stop what we are doing, and help us to do what Paul has instructed us to do. But also, Lord, we think of what you said, Lord Jesus, of that we must go out and make disciples. Help us, Lord Jesus, so that people can see you through us and that they can be attracted to us. Help us to love one another, that the church, your church, may stand up as one. And that when we stand up, that it would radiate such a bright light that everybody will come to us. So, Lord, we pray, help us to do just that. Oh, Lord, we thank you for the Trinity. And we thank you for each and every job and part that the Trinity plays in our lives. We thank you, Lord God, for being our Father. Dear Lord Jesus, for being our provider and for setting us free and for being our Redeemer. And Holy Spirit, for being our Advocate, our Counselor. Oh Lord, we can never understand fully, but all we can do is trust you and say thank you. Thank you, Lord. So let us conclude our service today with a song. And the words of this song have a particular meaning to me. If we look in the verse, the chorus of the after the verses, it says, freely, freely you have received. Now freely give. You know, the Lord gave himself. The Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Lord used all three parts of himself for us, to save us, to set us free. We have received his grace. Let us now spread his grace to everyone on earth. And you know what? He forgave our sin. The title of the song is God Forgave My Sin. and in Jesus' name, I've been born again. Come, let us sing.
Said freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I
Well, folks, that brings us to the end of our service today. So receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us here now today and forevermore. Amen. Folks, wishing you a wonderful week. May God bless you richly. And remember, when the going gets tough, reach out to the Lord, and He will help you. So until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and always remember that Jesus is only a prayer away. Goodbye now.